Support for Another Round comes from Squarespace. Go to squarespace.com today for a domain experience that's transparent and easy to set up. Just make sure you enter offer code Another Round at checkout to get 10% off. Make your next move with Squarespace. Hey y'all, what's up?
How you doing?
We have a secret.
What's the secret?
It's not really a secret. We've been talking about it for a while. we going to Chicago.
Hey.
It's going to be great. It's going to be June 21st, 8 o'clock p.m. at Talia Hall. We are going to sit down and talk to sociologist extraordinaire Eve Ewing.
Yes.
We're going to hang out, chit-chat with the one and only Jamila Woods.
Yes.
Voice of an angel. Oh, can't wait to hang out with her. And then we're going to have some fun with hip-hop youth crew Kumbalinks, who's going to dance and celebrate and turn up. And we will clap our hands while they do the actual dancing.
Exactly.
Because we don't, neither of us should be doing
that. Professionals handle this. Yo, shout out to Chicago. Y'all got some dope peoples.
And y'all also have a great zoo.
Also that.
I really like.
We'll explore that later.
Yeah, after the show, let's all go to the zoo. But first, you got to come to the show. For tickets and information, go to wbez.org/events. Come and see us.
Bring your person. Yeah. Bring us pizza.
Yeah.
Hi, everyone. I'm Heben.
I'm Tracy.
And welcome to another round with Heben and Tracy.
Yay! Noises of excitement.
Noises of excitement here.
Mm-hmm. Very formal. Noises of excitement. We're happy.
I'm so excited to be in the studio with friends of the show, Durga Chew-Bose and Doreen St. Felix.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. If you have been listening since day one or day two, Durga was our first guest.
Our ride or die.
Yes. Welcome back to our actual studio. Thanks for staying since
last time. Thank you for having me, guys.
Welcome, welcome.
You started us off on your episode was called Unlearning. Mm-hmm. I remember that.
I do too.
Our unlearning
I do too.
Journey.
I had no idea where this was going to go. And
hey,
here you guys are. Webby winners.
Yes.
Light work.
You know, Webby today, Oscar tomorrow, Pulitzer. Also in the studio with us today is the lovely and talented Doreen St. Felix. Hey, girl.
Hey, thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming. So Doreen is a staff writer at NewYorker.com, correct?
Yes.
Also, Light Flex recently had a cover piece. Kara Walker.
I did. Yeah, for New York Magazine.
Wow. I just wanted to say wow because it's fucking amazing to me.
Word.
I mean, it was a great experience. I also didn't know it was going to be the cover story until like 2 days before it came out.
Wow.
It was just this small detail.
Why?
I forgot to confirm.
How would you not know?
I don't know if something, you know, happened in the process of writing it, but it became the cover story.
They were like, oh, shit, basically.
Wow. What did it feel like to see the Kara Walker cover story, like, in newsstands, in people's hands?
Oh, I get really, like, emotional and excitable and, like, nervous. I'm just a ball of emotions.
Did you ever stop somebody that you saw with the magazine and be like, I wrote that, I did that, that was me?
No, just because.
The window's still open for that.
This time.
You got, like, 3 months after a cover story.
I was in a hair salon, though. I was getting my hair done, and the owner was reading it. And so I approached her because there was kind of like, you know, we had four walls between us. But I kind of, I don't know, I get off on the idea of like stuffy people reading this magazine and not knowing that the like young girl on the train next to them wrote the story.
Mm.
It's like, you know what? I can be anonymous in this way. It feels cool.
Oh, I love that.
Okay.
So the whole idea of PewPewPew with friends is that we have mad friends who we love who are really, you know, kind of wildly brilliant in their own quiet ways, and mm-hmm. we don't pepper them with odd questions enough, in my opinion.
Hard agree.
Yes.
The world needs more peppering with questions.
Yes. So I'm going to start off today. What do you bring to the potluck? It is almost cookout season, y'all.
Oh, shit.
What do you bring? What do you bring?
You know, it's going to be like 80 degrees every day soon enough.
Ooh.
And I have been thinking about this.
Okay. Okay. Talk to
me. Here's the thing. It depends. If you're going to a potluck where many white people will be, you have to make sure to not bring any drinks because that's all they know how to do.
Oh.
I have been to potlucks where it's literally only been beer and like crackers.
Wait,
so
what?
You have to. Yeah,
Durga's face was like,
aren't you familiar with this, Durga?
No, I don't go places a lot. I only show up like when the sun is setting and it's cooling off a little bit.
That's so smart.
Chic. I love that.
Yeah. I don't like getting day drunk and sweaty.
Oh, that's where you lost me. I love getting day drunk.
We're drinking right now.
Yeah. In the dark.
Fair. There are no windows.
That's
you got a point.
But all that's to say, I'm a big fan of pasta. It fills people
pasta
up.
Pasta at a potluck, at a barbecue.
It's
cold
cheap.
Cold pasta.
Cold pasta. You know, I might do a little bit of mozzarella cheese, some chicken, some tomato, a little bit of basil. Keep it very simple. People like that. Because
so
you don't want to get...
pasta salad.
Yeah. Yeah, but not like with anything creamy in it. Because I...
See, that's where my brain goes when you say pasta. Because my default is Alfredo. So I was like, that's a very
interesting... Oh, my default is Alfredo.
What is it, like 1989?
In my heart, yes, all the time. Actually.
I'm lactose intolerant.
Same.
So.
I just don't care.
Oh, my God.
I just don't respect
Tracy,
my body
I'm
enough.
Truly scandalized. How do you do that?
But cheese is so good.
Okay,
I have an
Tracy,
unhealthy
what
thing
you,
about cheese.
What are
okay.
you bringing to the potluck?
Cheese. No, I'm just kidding. Honestly, like, I tend to... err on the side of safety because I'm a decent cook, you know. Obviously, I know how to not starve, but
okay,
I'm not necessarily gonna like make like oh here's some what the fuck like macaroni and cheese or like potato salad or whatever. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing anything too fancy unless I'm the only one who's gonna be eating my attempt at a fancy meal. Say all this to say, I typically go with like a nice big fruit salad. Ain't nobody mad at fruit.
I'm not mad at a fruit
Who's
salad.
Mad at fruit?
Okay,
nobody's
so what do
fruit.
You put in the fruit salad, though? Nothing crazy?
Blackberries.
Ooh.
Strawberries.
A lot okay. of fiber.
Mm, yeah. Ooh, good. Girl, listen. Mangoes. Some yes. grapes. Sprinkle in there, maybe.
Okay.
What's not going to be in there is raspberries because they're hairy and I don't get it. I just don't.
Okay.
They are.
Ooh, pineapple, definitely in the salad. Mm. And you know what? In the middle of the day, what you do, you get you some fruit salad and just pour bourbon on everything.
Oh my gosh.
Let it soak. By the end of the night, fruit shots. If that's what you're into, I don't know. Maybe you're not.
Everyone's a little bit scandalized.
A little bit. I mean, you know what? It's fine.
Fruit shots. You're yeah. all writers I really admire.
Aww,
can I ask you? Can I ask you some process questions?
Ooh.
So yep. like, yeah. you just wrote a book, Durga. Not just, but it's been a process.
You wrote a book yesterday.
Your book is called "Too Much and Not the Mood," which accurate. Doreen, you've written a lot of things, but this Kara Walker profile is like one huge piece of your oeuvre.
Ooh, good word.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, hello.
And Tracy,
fancy.
You're working on a book.
I am.
What?
I'm terrified.
How do you start? How do you start?
Great question.
How do you start? Where do you begin?
I begin at the beginning of the piece because it's more than anything, it's extremely important for me to know the structure of it. And I can't know the structure until I have the lead, which is like, you know, the first paragraph or so that opens the story. And especially with the profile. So much is writing on that because that shit is long. Mm-hmm. You know, it's over 4,000 words. People are reading it online. You have to write something that's going to both entice but also establish what you're going to do. Mm. But I know a lot of writers who hate the idea of starting at the lead. You know, they'll write the whole body, write everything else, and then they'll deal with that in the end. So I'm saying that I'm special, basically.
I like that. Start where you know it needs to start.
I'm the same way if it's a piece of, like, if it's an essay, like a one-off. But with the book, it wasn't like that at all. It was like very much a lot of not writing anything. And then it just all started to happen. I think if you know you have this long-term project that no one's going to see for a long time, so you're not pressed to be super witty or smart or original. You just are pressed to kind of like wear, like you want to wear it down so that it fits you, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like, clothes that are brand new or whatever, you know, you have to wear it many times before you feel like it's home or something. And so there wasn't a lot of good writing happening at the start. I was just kind of like living in the piece. I was existing in the world as someone who knew she was writing a book. So like experiences kept feeling like they might end up in there, but I didn't know in what capacity or whatever. It was kind of just like wearing it for a long time.
How did you settle on the title?
I took it from Virginia Woolf's diary. So it's not even mine.
No, I love it. Can you tell me more?
Yeah.
Can you say more on it?
I was reading her writer's diary, and there was an entry from April 11th, 1931, and she was just having a really bad day. The great thing about Virginia Woolf's diaries is she's very comfortable with talking about who she doesn't like, gossiping about her editors.
Ooh.
Tea.
Okay.
Yes. And saying, like, when she just doesn't want to work. Mm. Like, she's not prideful about... you know, output in that way. She's quite comfortable with saying, like, today was a bad day. And that was a particularly bad day, and that was the last line. But honestly, it was just the way the words were strung together. Like, they feel like they're missing a word, but it's, like, all sentiment. And, yeah, I underlined it. And actually, our friend Dana Tortorici, I underlined it, and I sent it to her, and I said, wouldn't this make a great name for a book? And she was like, your book? Ooh. Maybe one day. Mm. And so, yeah.
Oh, I love that.
So you had the name for your book before the book even existed?
Yes. Hmm. Yes.
Is that similar for you?
Yes. I really like naming things, like whether it's a character in a story or just like one of the writing exercises I used to do when I used to like write a lot was I would think of or I would have other people like just invent titles of like a book or a movie or a poem and I would write something to fit it. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why, but that, like, it's a better frame for me versus, like, I'm going to sit down and write this thing and then title it later. And I think it's just because I'm better at, like, titles and stuff than, like, actually sitting down and writing a paragraph. So it's, like, a good way to be productive but procrastinate still. Like, I need to write, but let me sit down for 5 hours and think of a title. And it just feels like it's more accessible to me, like, than the whole of the story. And I feel like once, like, it's got a name, I can then, like, start to, like, build and layer.
I think one of the things that's very clear in all of your writing is that you have this like really rich way of seeing people and observing things. I'm curious what you observe in people in real life.
Who are you asking this to? Your eyes were like staring at all three of
us. I feel like that's such a Durga question.
I'm curious, like, when you first notice something about your crush, what do you first notice, Durga?
Oh. Okay, well, this is a question about crushes or writing. I guess it's the same thing.
I feel like people who are observational in their writing make great just like romantic crushes.
You know what? I think the first thing I notice often is how someone might have their own way of interpreting a situation, and that could be like a physicality, like how everyone else is sitting. They might be sitting differently, how mm-hmm. they're leaning, how they're they use their hands. It's sort of like I notice how people express themselves when they're not the center. When they're not, you know,
like the one talking.
Yeah, when they're not mm-hmm. the one talking and they're just being, but they've, you know, come into themselves or developed tics or something, then I'm always really drawn to that.
Hmm. The Tracy, way that people act when they think nobody's looking.
Yes, mm. yes. Exactly.
I know you've talked about fingernails too.
Yeah, I like the, kind of in a similar way, like the little bitty things about a person that somebody might not notice. Like when most people like find or notice somebody, they're like, oh my gosh, such a nice smile, like such a nice whatever. But I'm also like very into like body language and like I really love watching two people interacting like at dinner. I'm like, okay, what's the story? Is this a Tinder date? It's usually a Tinder date. And like, is she leaning like, is she into him? Is she leaning very close or is she kind of like turned away? And I think that I like to do that because then I get to like spin my own little story, which is kind of funny, kind of cute. But yes, fingernails always make me wonder like what was your day like? Like, you know, like my shit for the first time is like freshly manicured. Why is that? I had a party to go to last week. What kind of party was it? Blah, 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 blah. And there's like this whole other story. I hate to see a man with just like dirty, gross, disgusting fingernails. I instantly think the worst of this person, which is not fair because maybe he's just a hardworking man, you know? And so then I have a whole conversation with myself about it.
I can see this predicament you're in.
Yeah. At least once a day this happens.
Doreen?
I love to see people in their homes or whatever space they might spend more time in than any other. And that's mostly because it kind of forces them to narrate their lives in a way that I think is uncomfortable for anyone because you're like, oh, like, where did you get, like, this trinket from? Or with Kara, she had a trophy
that's
case.
That's Kara Walker, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. The artist, the American artist, yes. Kara Walker.
Yes.
She had a trophy case in her living room that she bought at a flea market, and inside of it were all of these, like, tchotchkes, basically. Mm. And one of these things was a box of mints that she got from President Obama's first inauguration and just like had his face on this little tin box.
I love that.
And it's just amazing to see somebody kind of like pick up an object like that, thumb it, and then you see their eyes like go off into the distance and they think about being in that scenario. So it's a really great, excuse me, I'm already tipsy.
Yeah.
It's a great way to for someone to write out their own stories in sometimes like oblique or peripheral ways.
Mm. What about you, Ev? What do you know? Or am I allowed to?
You're allowed to talk to me.
How do you notice and observe people?
I think I notice people's laughs first, to be honest.
Hmm.
There's
it's because you have a really good laugh.
Yeah, you really do. It's like the platonic ideal of a laugh.
Wow. Oh my gosh.
True.
Yeah, that's right. Laugh for us.
Oh my goodness. I just feel like I don't mean necessarily the laugh itself, but like when people are earnest in their laughter or when they're withholding of it, it's always interesting to me.
I have a question for the room. Speaking of Heben's laugh, how would you describe Heben's laugh?
Stop.
Oh, wow.
I think it's a good exercise. It's people who like notice stuff about people. You know?
I think it escalates.
Yes, exactly.
You have an escalating laughter.
Your laugh is like, I picture it when you're looking at the bars, like on a recording, and you just like look at the bars to see like mm-hmm. how the sound is changing or rising or whatever. Your laugh looks like that.
Ooh, that is good.
I love that. Wow.
That's great.
I'm putting that in my Twitter bio.
Whenever you laugh, especially like, so you have different laughs.
Oh my God.
One of my favorite ones is the one that starts off really low and then it gets like louder and higher gradually. And it always, whenever I
laugh.
Do it. Punctuate all of my points. But it always makes me envision like a pot of water on a stove that goes from like still to boiling really, really fast. And like it starts at your toes and it like starts to bubble, then it's just like and then the pot is boiling.
Also, your laugh is pure appreciation. It's not just reaction.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I truly do not know what to say. I am not like a loss.
Is this uncomfortable?
For words. It is extremely uncomfortable. I feel grateful for your, oh my goodness, for your observations to be,
you.
Yes, to have been observed. Can I change the tone entirely?
Yes.
Talk to me about the porches in your life.
I love this question.
There's like a passage in Durga's book
that
like just a whisper of a sentence that like stood out to me. And I was like, I know Tracy's got a porch story. She'd be living in a porch.
I am in love with porches. I'm so in love with porches. I was in Flatbush a couple days ago walking towards Cortelyou and like Didmus Park and stuff, looking for like a cute little brunch place. And all of a sudden I was like, it feels like I'm someplace else. Like this doesn't feel like New York. It doesn't feel like Brooklyn even. And I was like, what's different? And I was like, there are lawns and porches. It's just like this block or two with lawns and porches. I don't know where else in Brooklyn I've ever seen it because everything is like brownstones and like little brick courtyard or whatever. But I got so happy and so excited because my summers in Kentucky, like with no job, no money, no nothing, no business, no place to go, no car to get there, we just sat on the porch like from when I was like 5 until I was like 15 and still had no business and no job and no money to go anywhere. Just sit on the porch, see who drives by, see who walks by, read a book maybe, have you some lemonade, blah, 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 blah.
Yes.
And it was just such a staple of just like... Like, that was my resting state for so long. So much so that once I went to college in Lexington, which was just stressful. It was 10 black people, 20 black people there, excuse me, 20 out of 1,100. And me and my black-ass friends were like, okay, it's a Friday. What do we do? Where do we go? There's nowhere to just hang out. And on the corners of the campus, there were these two really big stone-like walls that said Transylvania University. And we were like, we're just going to sit on the sign. And so every weekend, me and my two black friends would just sit on the sign on either corner of this white-ass school.
We made it your porch.
And we made it our porch. And there was this one day. I have so many sign stories.
I can't believe you made it your porch.
we live here now.
Basically. And it was at once like, okay, we just need something to do. But also, like, we want people to know that there are black people at this school because nobody fucking knew. Nobody knew. We were out there one day with a sign that said honk because it was my birthday. And there was so much honking that the president came out. He was like, it's a little too loud. It's a little too much. So say all that to say, I love me a porch or a big ass sign on a school campus.
I love that you made yourself a porch. I didn't know you could DIY porches like that.
Listen, sometimes you have to turn the world into your porch.
Be the porch you wish to see.
Be the porch you wish to see in the world.
I actually have an opposite understanding of New York when it comes to lawns and open spaces and porches, because I grew up in Canarsie, which is a neighborhood full of either fully detached houses or semi-attached houses. So there's like a lot of lawn space and a lot of backyard space. And when I like, you know, got the scholarship at 13 years old that enabled me to have the job that I have right now, I had to transition to a totally different part of New York that I had never seen before. Mm. So for us, like every day after school, a lot of our mothers, I lived in a really West Indian block in Canarsie, they would want us to water the grass, right? Aww. And so all we would do was just kind of like hang out on our porches and water the grass from there. So you would like point all the water from the hose in one spot until the grass was dead. But we had, you know, a similar kind of relationship to our green space. Mm. But then when I went to school in the city, I was on the Upper East Side, I was like, y'all don't have grass. Like, y'all are richer than me.
Right.
Like, to this day, I really don't subscribe to the idea that, like, you are more wealthy because you have more vertical space. For me, it's always been about horizontal space. And porches, you know, they're literally, like, they take up a lot of square footage. They mean that your home has to be, like, big and imposing in this way, even if it's, like, worth a 20th. What a brownstone might be in Manhattan or elsewhere. So yeah, I miss porches. I wish I got to interact with them more.
It also means that you make yourself visible because it's like your inside space outside, and so you don't like come in, close your door, like draw your blinds, have your private life. You know, like you continue your life outside, and people have to see you and see your family and like hear your voices and complain about the noise or whatever. But you have to kind of, people have to see you. You know, and so I feel like the moment you walk in a neighborhood where there aren't porches or outside space, it feels sort of like isolating. Like I don't know,
it feels both isolating but also surveilled in this way.
Yeah.
Because, you know, like
people can look out on you but you can't see them.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So there's like very little interaction, which is why it always sucks when, you know, I have friends who moved to formerly black neighborhoods and their neighbors like call the police on them because they're sitting on the stoop. You know, the stoop is like an appropriated porch,
exactly,
basically.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, you don't understand, like, you don't just live in your home. Like, you live outside of your home and approximate to it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that shit is whack. Don't call the police on your neighbors.
Right. For being in the neighborhood.
There were a lot of little observations in your book that, like, tickled me. And one of the things is that, like, why does every white girl want to be a marine biologist? Oh, it was just, like, a stray detail in your observation about, like, the high school girls and, you know, what those white girls you kind of, like, envied from afar were like.
Yeah. It was a moment, too. I feel like maybe some movie must have come out with a dolphin or something.
Like that Disney Channel movie?
Yeah, there must
have. Dolphin-related,
yeah,
I'm sure.
There must have been some movie where, like, the lead character was, like, working in an aquarium or something. But I think it was also this, like, way of, I don't know why, but it was, like, that job, I think, that people associated to, like, having a keen interest in something. Like, I think it made them seem original, but then everybody wanted to do it or something.
But then also having an asociality, right? It's like, I'm just going to enter the ocean because I can't be bothered with you beings on land. But also when you do that portrait of white girls in, like, middle school and high school, the way that you describe how their hair is wet in the morning resonated with me so much because it felt like such an imposition and, like, such a way of being, like, sloppy that I could never muster.
Well, me
first
too.
Of all, when my hair is wet, it's an inch off my motherfucking scalp because that's the way that shit goes. So
also,
logistically, it
also
work.
Like my parents still are, you know, under the belief system that you get a cold if you go out with wet hair.
Yeah.
So like I would have swimming
that's
lessons.
Not true.
Well, exactly. Who knows? Who knows? But my parents used to make me, after swimming lessons, duck my head under the hand dryer at the YMCA and not come home. Unless my hair was dry, because they were like, you're going to catch a cold. They still say it to me. Like, you're going to catch a cold is like I don't even know if it's a sentence anymore. It's like a sound.
It's my parents. Catch a cold. Yeah.
Exactly. That's exactly it. No matter what, like if I'm wearing a jacket and I haven't zipped it up.
Oh, yeah.
Like my parents hated that time when I started to buy small coats that actually didn't zip.
Because they were cute though.
They were cute, but they were like, this doesn't zip up.
Right. What's the point? There's no functionality to it.
My mom hates my clavicle. Like anytime she sees it.
Wait.
And
wait,
it's,
mom.
What? Yeah, that's you're going to get a chest cold.
Exactly.
It's always a chest cold. I don't even know what a chest cold is.
If it's 80 degrees outside, maybe it's okay for me to have my upper chest out. But she sees it and she's just like, oh, God, cover
up.
Yeah,
the sternum bone.
Yeah.
You're going to get a chest cold.
Mm-hmm. That's kind of how
I don't think I've ever gotten a chest cold.
Yeah, so I'm saying I don't know what it is.
That's what my cousin used to say. day my older cousin to be like, you're showing too much boob and you need to put it up. He's like, oh, you're going to get a chest cold.
Oh, but
I get it.
I don't like that. I don't like that at all.
I wasn't a fan, you know?
I think when my parents said it, it was more from the, like, immigrant parent, like, where do colds come from sort of weirdness. Because when we say, like, we have a cold, it's like, bird metang, like the old man winter punched me.
Damn.
Is kind of.
Jeez.
Is kind of. That's we're so the dramatic people.
It's beautiful, but it's intense.
But that's what our parents are thinking.
Yeah,
when
they're
say
like,
it.
Your chest, like, it, yeah. it will hit you in the chest. Yes. That's what they're saying.
So, what's the background of the white girl, white, wet hair story?
I think it was just like one of those observations of me being half curious and envious that they were allowed to come to school. Mm-hmm. Also, it was a sign for me that, you know, like, for me, showering is like multi steps. And they seem to be skipping one, which was the drying off stage.
You're
not like, why do they get to do that?
So
I think it was that too. But also, I mean, it was a lot of things. It was my parents not letting me out of the house with wet hair, but also them just showing up. And it feel like also the drying off stage when you're in your school uniform, opening your locker. I was kind of like, wait, you should have done that at home. You know, I don't know.
Was there ever like a look or a sort of, I don't know, one of these like 90s fashion things that's come back in style that you still own? I'm always curious about like high school looks you kept.
Actually, you know the Steve Madden platform sandals
yes.
that everybody is like trying to be brand new about right now?
Talk to us, Doreen. Talk to us.
I never threw mine out. Yes. The thing about me is that I went through a growth spurt unnaturally early. I became the size that I am now at 10 years old. I've been the same size for forever. I still wear clothes that I had in middle school. But I remember that those shoes were really important to me because they were a way of wearing heels that were, like, acceptable to my family.
Yeah.
Because it was all, like, one height. Having the shoe was a way of me, like, becoming taller and being more imposing than I already was. Mm. But also placating my mother. It was like, okay, I'm not going to get, like, a boyfriend now. Don't worry.
It took
calm
me down.
It took me 10 extra years to get a boyfriend at age 10.
So do you still wear them?
Yeah, sometimes. Yeah. But now I feel annoyed because all these girls are trying to like reclaim the Steve Madden shoe.
They biting you, Sam.
The Steve Madden shoe.
Where were you when we were shooting the club? Like, stop! I've been doing this for a minute.
All right, we got Rick Ross in the building.
Durga, why are you shaking your head at me?
I don't know. It just happens so naturally. It's all love.
I love it.
Mine is actually not even that original. It was just that I was into sports, and so I played on the soccer team, and we had a school uniform. So after you had to put, you know, your knee-high socks back on and your kilt and your shirt, but all the girls who were on the soccer team would put on our Adidas slides still.
We would
take the bus home with our school uniform, but our Adidas slides, and so then when people started wearing them again like 3 years ago, outside, like not as slippers. I mean, Doreen smiled at me one day because I had friends over at my apartment for dinner and I was like wearing a nice silk shirt, jeans, socks, and my slides. I was like, slippers in the house.
Well, now they've become this totem and athleisure, as it were.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is a lovely term. Athleisure.
It's on the way out.
You think so?
Yes.
God bless.
It looks like you're hoping so, too.
Pardon? I don't think so.
It looks like you're hoping that it's on its way out.
Yeah, I like a little sophistication.
I like a little effort in my look.
Yes. No, you know what? I associate it a little bit also to the wet hair.
That's interesting. Lemon girls.
Yeah. Where you get to go out without being completely put together and perfect.
Yeah. Mm. You know, like I don't think I could ever wear leggings as pants. Mm.
Oh, this is controversial.
Girl, you missing
my
out.
Butt is too big for that.
I mean, same, but it feels good.
Because it's going to stretch the fabric and then it's going to be see-through.
Okay.
You know what
you
I mean?
I know. You all know.
I love it though. I'm just too thick for the leggings. And they just stretch.
Tracy, do you have any, like maybe some hoop earrings?
I've never abandoned the hoop earrings. Mm. My first really big pair of hoop earrings, like big enough for me to like put my hand through, I still have. They're still in Louisville. They are an artifact. I will not let anybody touch them, even though
them
the silver
Black
whatever
Sony.
Is like wearing off. And like it's just like
sure
copper now.
Is.
Pretty basic.
I feel like I'm just so embarrassed whenever a thing comes back in style.
Why?
It's like, we've been through this before, guys. You know, I don't know. It's just a little part of me feels like shame, and then I'm like, I put on my choker.
And then you're like, oh, it's cute.
We and then I'm like, but I look cute, though. But I'm cute, though.
Okay, y'all, we are going to be right back. We got some business to take care of, mainly getting more drinks and paying some bills. Somebody's got to do it. Guess it's going to be us. Support for Another Round comes from Squarespace. With Squarespace, you get a unique domain experience that's simple to set up and an all-in-one platform to help you create a beautiful, modern website that's nothing like those old dial-up websites. You remember that sound? To help quiz me on some other old-school computer sounds, I have with me Tyler Sorensen from BuzzFeed's creative department. Hello, Tyler.
Hey, Tracy.
What you got? What you got?
Here is your vintage computer sound.
This is what a printer used to sound like.
Yeah, you're right.
A line printer.
It had the sprocket holes on the sides.
Yeah.
Is that what you're talking about?
Uh-huh.
I remember those, yeah.
Oh, man. My mother used to have one, and I used to love to rip the sides of the paper off.
Yeah.
But I would do it on clean paper.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I would get in all kind of trouble. Get your unique domain today at squarespace.com. If you sign up for a year, the domain is free, and you can also save 10% off your first purchase with the offer code AnotherRound, as in the name of the show that you're listening to right now. Make your next move with Squarespace. Would you rather have a foot-long nose, a nose that is 1 foot long, or a tongue that is 1 foot long? There's
oh,
nothing
Tracy.
Left in my cup, but I'm going to pretend to sit.
This is a nasty question. Isn't my mind supposed to go that way?
It's obviously supposed to.
I mean, it's supposed to go wherever it goes. Heben.
I would choose the tongue. I'll buy what you're selling here.
Disadvantages. It would be really hard to talk. Like, do you keep it all in your mouth? Does it just hang out? If it's hanging out, it's going to get dry. You got to, like, mist it or something to keep it, you know?
No, but I was imagining I could roll it up like bubble tape gum.
Ooh.
You know that?
Yeah.
And I would open
or
my mouth.
By the
and,
foot.
Yes, I would open my mouth and people
oh
would be
God.
Very freaked out by this, like, cylinder.
By this fruit by the foot situation in your mouth.
But then I wouldn't have a foot long nose. So.
Okay.
Yeah, I feel like the nose would just be cumbersome in public spaces.
What if you could, like, pin it? Not pin it because it would hurt, but like secure it somehow with like a really cute bow or something. What if somebody made a line of nose holders?
Stop it. And that's what everybody was just racking.
Yes.
When's the last time you cackled?
2 minutes ago,
I
think.
I mean, I always cackle. You don't cackle. I don't think Durga cackles.
Sorry. You were rolling.
I didn't say anything.
He's like testing it.
I was like, what's happening over there? Did you start my own show?
Durga, do you not have a cackle? What?
No. I probably cackle if I'm around like cousins or like aunts and stuff, because then it just gets out of control. Like breakfast turns into dinner kind of thing. Like those days when you're just complete, when you just stay in a kitchen all day, that's probably the scenario. But I'm like really self-conscious about my laugh.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
I feel like you have a silent cackle.
Oh, in my head, I'm cackling all the time.
Well, you also have a bodily laugh.
Oh,
do I?
Yeah. So
do you
sometimes...
do an impression of this laugh?
Okay, listeners, imagine that I am, like, slightly bouncing up and down in my chair. And
like a baby?
No, it's, like, it's the slightest bounce. It's the loveliest bounce.
I agree.
And, you know, like, you do the laugh that I think a lot of women do. It's, like, you know, you kind of, like, put your hand by your face.
Mm-hmm.
And aww. I love laughs like that because I think that it takes – courage isn't the word, but like I just love to see women given to their bodies, you know, in public.
It always looks like to me like you're like saving a little bit for yourself.
Yeah,
like, I think laughter catches me off guard, to be honest, because I don't think I'm as prone to it as I actually am. And so when I laugh, especially with friends and family, I remember like, oh, joy is like a real part of my existence.
Yes,
but you also laugh and roll your eyes.
Oh, yes,
which is like the best
because wait, like at the same time.
Yeah, it's because because, you know, she thinks I'm funny, but she's also, like, shading me a little bit, which is the standard every female friendship should have.
Oh, my gosh. So Durga is your heaven. Durga is yes. Heaven is to me. Aww.
I love that.
We're going to start our own podcast.
Yes. Another drink.
That was like, God. That was like, we went for dinner recently and someone ordered salad and they were like, here's the salad. And they passed it to me and Doreen and it was just cheese and tomato. And we're like, yeah. One green.
Yeah.
And also, we never order a salad.
So we were just like, okay. And then I think we were laughing, rolling our eyes. Like, it's just like, it's like a shorthand. Mm-hmm. I don't know. But again, I think it's all appreciation.
Yes.
I'm like, this is a beautiful note to end on because female friendships is so important.
Yes.
And I just love to see it.
Cheers to laughter and friendship.
Cheers to laughter and friendship and to being amazing writers and having books and stuff. Plug stuff. Where can people find you and your work? What's going on? What's
new? What are all the million things you're working on?
Yeah, yeah.
I just started a new job.
Woo-woo!
I am a staff writer at NewYorker.com.
Hey,
which is very exciting.
I told Doreen I'm really excited to see what her illustration is of her face.
I think so. I feel the same way. Yeah, I'm like, should I have braids? Should I have crochet? Should I cut all my hair off? There's a lot of things that I could do.
Oh, my God. Is that an option? I'm so excited.
I don't know. Maybe. I guess I'll find out soon enough.
Where can they find you on Twitter?
Oh, my Twitter and my Instagram handle are the same. It's at D St. Felix, DSTFELIX.
Where can people find me? I tweet sometimes, but, you know, I'm obnoxious and I tweet observations.
I love it.
I'm very consistently myself, you know? Like, I very rarely go off into left fields.
You're on brand. That's allowed.
Oh, no.
No, it's okay. It's okay to be on brand.
Okay.
I'm trying to embrace the whole branding shit.
Okay.
It's hard. It's not going well. It's tough. I'm not doing it well.
Brand in a good way.
Yeah.
Yes, in a good
way.
But
I'm like, who's paying me?
Yeah, that's the thing. I ain't figured all that yet, but you know.
I tweet and I wrote a book that you can find at your local independent bookstore.
Awesome.
Support your bookstores.
All right. And again, the title is Too Much and Not the Mood.
It's been lovely, y'all.
Ladies, this was great. Please come back and drink more brown liquor with us and cackle silently.
I would love to.
Yay! Thank you. Yeah.
Tracy, who you bound around for?
So my round's going to be pretty quick.
Okay.
The other day, I was listening to random Beyonce songs, as one does.
Ooh.
And Irreplaceable came on.
Okay.
That is a solid ass song.
I feel like that song has fallen into the almost the like single ladies of just played too much. I cannot listen to it again.
I understand.
To the point where you forget that it is a genius masterpiece classic.
And I think that's where this is how I came to this realization because I couldn't get to the computer fast enough to skip it. But then I stopped listening to the lyrics and I'm like, you know what?
Neo, I slept on this.
Neo put his foot and his entire little milk dud ass head in this. He killed like the...
He sure did.
You know, rolling her around in the car that I bought you? What?
Wow.
So that's all. It's just a good song.
I saw that video so much in Spanish for some reason when I was traveling this one summer. Mm-hmm. So that on top of it being played too much is just like, I can't listen to that song.
Oh, she did release it in Spanish.
Remember when she used to be doing that all crazy?
That was a thing in R&B
history.
Beyonce
with the Spanish B-side.
Yeah.
All right, let me tell you real quick about something that I'm just like, oh my God, God bless.
Mm-hmm.
There is an undo send button on Gmail.
An undo send button.
On your computer, open Gmail. In the top right, click settings.
Wait, hold on. I'm opening Gmail.
In your settings, you can find a little button that lets you like have an option to undo send once you send an email.
I see it. Oh my gosh. Wait, how does this work? Ooh. So right here under settings, there's a little box that says enable undo send, and you can choose 5, 10, 20, or 30 seconds. Bruh.
So, I don't know why I, a grown-ass adult, cannot just, like, take 10 seconds and proofread my emails.
Who has time for that? You know what you can do in those 10 seconds?
I know. I'd be just sending them. in these emails.
Fly, my pretties, fly.
Exactly. And sometimes you need a little more discretion.
Mm-hmm. That's true. That's true.
And this little undo send pops up, mm-hmm. and you can click undo within whatever time period you select. I obviously chose the most amount of time to regret my decision. And I have used it so many times to catch typos,
really?
To catch little shifts in mood. I feel like I'm so bad at email. I always ask Tracy to read mine to be like, does this sound like a human would say this? Am I a human in this email?
Wait, I'm going to try to send you an email and then undo the send.
But honestly, y'all, it saved me so many times. And I don't know if you all have heard the good word, but I would like to spread the good word.
We did it. Again.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen.
Can you believe?
Neither me nor Tracy. Never can.
Thank you so much to our friends, our girlfriends.
Yes!
Thank you to Doreen St. Felix for stopping by. You can find her on Twitter at DSTFelix. That's F-E-L-I-X. And you should absolutely read her cover story on Kara Walker.
And also, like, everything she writes.
Oh, yeah. Tweets, articles, all of that stuff.
Just literally anything.
Just do it. Also, thank you to Durga Chew-Bose for coming back for the second time.
Yes.
Since she was our very first guest.
Our inaugural guest.
Oh, now that we're walking and stuff, she can come back and be like, hey, we can, like, play basketball and stuff now. It's cute. You can find her on Twitter at Durga Polashi. That is DURGAPOLASHI. Make sure you get her book, Too Much and Not the Mood, because it's going to be my mood for the rest of my life.
Yes. And shout out to the Paw Squad.
Paw Squad. Paw, paw, paw. This episode was produced by Nina Potuck and Julia Ferlin with editorial oversight from Eleanor Kagan and Meg Kramer. And the top-notchest, top-of-the-linest, A-plusest production support.
Yes.
From Agarinesh Ashagre and Alex Laughlin. Shout out to our in-house musicians, Miss Jean Gray. You can follow her on Twitter at Jean Greasy. And Don Will of Tanya Morgan, which sounds like a lady, but it's actually a rap group. You can follow him at Don Will on Twitter. You can follow Heben at Heben Rants.
True.
You can follow me at Broken McPoverty.
Also true.
You can follow the show at Another Round.
On Facebook, Twitter, all the things.
All of the things. We have made communicating with us so easy for you.
And you can email us at anotherround@buzzfeed.com as well.
Do all the things.
All the things. Mm-hmm.
Including rating us on iTunes. Telling a friend.
Telling a friend.
You know what? Even, like, if there's somebody in your life and you're just like, you know, I don't really fuck with them like that.
But I still want joy in their life.
Yeah. Because you recognize that when you put joy in another person, then it then gets into the world.
Yes, it comes back to you.
Tell your frenemies.
Yes.
To listen to the show. Subscribe to our newsletter. It's got lots of fun goodies and stuff in it. You can do that at buzzfeed.com/anotherround/newsletter.
Drink some water.
Take your meds. Call your mom.
All your peoples. I would say invest in, like, a little password protector situation.
Ooh.
Get your cybersecurity game up. How many passwords you got, Tracy? You should have infinity passwords.
I don't have infinity passwords.
Well, yeah, I don't know why I yelled that.
Do you have infinity passwords?
No, but I could.
Oh, okay. Yeah, true, fair.
Don't use the same password for everything is all I'm saying, okay?
Ooh, you know what you should also do? Go through all the pictures in your camera phone and, like, delete all of the, like, the little accidental snaps and just, like, all the pictures that you already Instagram said that you don't want to keep.
Save you some space.
Save you some space. It's
okay.
Easy.
Okay.
I think it's because I don't have any space on my phone.
Back up your data.
Yeah, they do.
Bye.
Bye.